At the dawn of history, an entire civilization gathered to build the most intriguing monuments on Earth. Why? What vision drove them? Robert Bauval, British author and researcher, born in Egypt under the shadow of the Great Pyramids. Tombs for dead pharaohs, say Egyptologists, but Bauval believes there was a far greater vision behind them. Over the last 20 years, he quested for that greater meaning, echoed in ancient whispers of myths, of stars.
There is something very remarkable about the civilization, its consistency. It never changed. Its art, its religion, its temples, its laws, even the way they dressed remained the same. Why? Because it was meant to be so.
10 years ago, Bauval made a discovery that fired the world's imagination. Mysterious shafts inside the Great Pyramid of Giza, long thought to be for ventilation, aimed at stars. Those on the south side, at the constellation of Orion and the star Sirius, to ancient Egyptians, the god Osiris and his son Horus. Those on the north, at the pole star and the Big Dipper. And the complex itself, three pyramids in a row, but one smaller and offset to the left, seemed to mirror the three belt stars of Orion. Orion, Egypt's god Osiris, stood in heaven as on earth. Do the pyramids speak of stars?
Pyramids are not very popular with Egyptologists because they've attracted so many cranks.
The Great Pyramid has this power over people. In my view, it has the power to destroy common sense.
You know, Mr. Bauval and Mr. X and Mr. Z, all these people, they come by for a day or two to the plateau, and they come by with a theory, but all of it gone with the wind.
But Bauval's theory didn't go with the wind. Even though careful not to mention his name, Bauval's ideas galvanized some Egyptologists to look more closely at the stars.
I think that many of the most productive ideas are first of all looked upon as, the man's mad. Secondly, all right, let's look at his ideas and show where the error is. And the third stage for many advances is, of course, I always knew this to be true.
British astronomer Archie Roy helped found a new branch of science, archeo-astronomy, which studies how ancient peoples viewed the skies and expressed their awe in their monuments. It uses computers to recreate the skies of the past and find what they might have meant to ancient peoples.
Unfortunately, there is a tendency for Egyptologists who perhaps haven't much training in the history of astronomy not to feel that heavenly events controlled the terrestrial events.
The thing is that we've stopped observing nature. We don't look at the sky anymore. We don't look at the stars. We don't look at the sun. Some people hardly see sunrise in cities. And the flood doesn't exist anymore here in Egypt. It's all controlled by dams and barrages. We don't observe. The Egyptians were the masters of observation. Through the night, they could see the stars, the Milky Way, in all its glory. They would see the stars move to their point of death in the west at sunset. That's where the stars die. That is observable. And therefore the dead must enter the cosmic world, as do the stars in the west.
Egypt was deeply aware of the universe around and felt ruled by the laws of the cosmic order.
This cosmic order was given at the beginning of time. This order was perfect and maintained a harmony and balance with the natural world and the cosmos. As above, so below. It was known as Mat. And it ruled the world of the gods and the world below.
Cosmic order, Mat, the idea with which the Egyptians touched eternity and the slow, majestic movements of time.
The Egyptians saw the world and time in a very different way. We rush ahead towards God knows where, always going forward, never to come back to the point of origin. They saw time in cycles, eternally coming back to the point of origin.
These cycles of time are grafted in Egypt's myth of creation. In the beginning, a mound emerged from an ocean of chaos. On it appeared the creator, the sun god Ra.
The first sunrise takes place on this mound. And the first appearance of life, a magical bird, the firebird, the phoenix, comes and he utters the first cry. And by doing so, he begins time.
The cry of the phoenix set in motion the cycles of the cosmic order, the wheels of time. And when the cycle is completed, the phoenix will rise again to set a new circle in motion. On that mound of creation, later Heliopolis was built, the city of the sun, Egypt's great center of learning, where priests formulated its idea of the universe. And there's something about the land of Egypt itself which explains why its people felt ruled by Maat, the cosmic order that governed the cycles of nature.
The whole of Egypt would be like this, were it not for one miracle of nature.
Egypt is the gift of the Nile, and the Nile, since time immemorial, performs a cycle.
Each year, like clockwork, the waters of the Nile would rise and flood the land, turning the whole of Egypt into a miracle of abundance and prosperity. So if you really want to understand ancient Egypt, you must understand the Nile and its cycles. This is what Egypt was all about, its magic, its wisdom, and above all, its concept of cyclical time and eternity. And it is no wonder that they focused entirely on this yearly miracle.
A yearly miracle. Each year, as a scorching sun approached the summer solstice in mid-June, Egypt lay parched and dying under the heat of the midsummer sun. Each year, the Nile was reduced to a trickle where men and animals fought for survival. But unknown to the ancient Egyptians, great lakes in Africa filled to the brim with monsoon rains and caused the torrent of water to rush northwards to the rescue of Egypt. Each year, Egypt was reborn. It expressed its awe for this yearly miracle of resurrection in its gods. Green as the new crop was the color of the god of rebirth, lord of the afterlife, Osiris. The flocks of ibis flying in just hours before the floods seemed heralds of an imminent rebirth and became symbol of great Thoth, the lord of wisdom and herald of the gods.
The ancient Egyptians were keen observers of nature, and they could not help noticing that the cycle of the Nile matched perfectly with the cycle of the sun and the stars.
And there, Egypt saw other, even greater cosmic players in the yearly ritual of rebirth. The brightest star in the skies, Sirius, would be out of sight for 70 days. But at the dawn of summer solstice, just before sunrise and the coming of the floods, Sirius would suddenly reappear and twinkle over the horizon.
These 70 days were seen as a period of magic and metamorphosis of the star. So important were these 70 days that when they prepared the mummy, they left the mummy for 70 days before they celebrated the rebirth. And they waited. And by wonderful miracle, the star reappeared as prescribed at dawn, at exactly the time that they had seen in the previous times. It appeared when the sun would rise at the summer solstice and at the time when the flood would come.
It is no wonder that this star became the star of rebirth in one of man's greatest myths. A myth of the first time, Zep Tepi, the golden age when gods ruled, and Osiris and his consort Isis brought splendor, wisdom, and knowledge to the land of Egypt. But Seth, his brother, grew jealous, betrayed, and killed Osiris. The world fell to chaos as Seth cut up the body of Osiris and hid each part throughout the land, and blood and darkness came over Egypt. But Isis, the faithful consort, searched every corner of the land and gathered the part of her beloved Osiris and bound them in linen as the first mummy to enter afterlife.
However, she could not find the phallus, and she fabricated a golden phallus from which she impregnated herself with the seed of Osiris and bore a son, the son Horus, the divine child. It is Horus that became the first established man-god, first pharaoh to rule Egypt. And all pharaohs that followed believe themselves to be reincarnated entities of Horus.
A myth of rebirth, as Egypt itself was reborn each year, a conception it also saw in heaven at that magical time of the year when the Nile floods came.
This was the magical moment they were waiting for every year. This was the great day of rebirth, with the constellation of Orion hovering in the east, looking down as if heralding the event.
Orion is Osiris, and then you see the constellation of the goddess Isis, Canis Majori. And it is from within that constellation, as if from the womb of the goddess Isis, that emerges the star Sirius, which is Horus. Horus is the star Sirius, the star of the divine child.
And this is what they saw, the bright star of Horus, the star Sirius, its light appearing for the first time at dawn, blending, merging with the rays of the new sun at the summer solstice.
The star reborn after 70 days, transforming into the glory of the rising sun, became Horus of the horizon, Ra Horakhti. When the floods came, when Egypt was reborn, and when the portals of heavens opened.
And look at this. Here is Seth blessing the pharaoh in opposition to Horus, his arch enemy. This means that order and disorder are part of the cosmic balance. And Seth has an important role in his stellar form, the constellation of the Big Dipper.
The Egyptians also called it the Thigh. One of the shafts in Giza's Great Pyramid is aimed at it, the opposite one pointing at Sirius, making this monument into a metaphor of resurrection, the quest for life after death, when souls went to the kingdom of Osiris and joined the stars in heaven. But where in heaven? This shaft inside the Great Pyramid seems to give an answer.
When the Egyptian looked at the night sky in the north, they saw a group of constellations going round and round the pole in 24 hours. These were the circumpolar stars. The Egyptians called them the imperishable, the stars that never die. And the reason is because these stars never set. And not surprisingly, they wanted to join these stars for eternity. Now we know that there was a very important ritual involving those stars to align the pyramids and temples.
The pharaoh and a priestess representing a goddess called Sashet would stretch a cord between them to define the direction of the temple, align it to the stars.
And this is what he was aiming at. He was aiming at the group of stars going round and round the pole, the imperishable, the stars that never die. And most particularly, he was looking at this constellation, the constellation we call the Big Dipper, and that they call the Thigh.
For there was another reason to focus on these stars.
The circumpolar stars literally go round and round in 24 hours. You can use them as a clock. Now, they also noticed that the relative position between the star that they watched in the Big Dipper and the star Sirius was very close to 90 degrees, almost like a set square. So as you shifted, all you have to do is know when a certain star is at a certain place to predict the rising of the star Sirius.
In defining the direction of the temple, aligning it to the stars, it all came together. Myth, magic, and the cosmic law. It was a way to know when the floods would come, a way to predict the yearly miracle that brought life back to Egypt. For Bauval, rediscovering this almost forgotten ritual was a breakthrough.
And look, here is Sesha, who aligns the temple to the stars of the Big Dipper. It's written everywhere.
The second breakthrough came when he began finding the code encrypted in stone. This is the Pharaoh Djoser, who began the Great Pyramid Age. This statue is also found in a mysterious stone cubicle, buttressed against this pyramid in a strange angle.
It was a lucky turn of the spade that this unique monument was found undamaged. It was long thought that Djoser was looking at the magical and sacred rituals in the courts. But he could not do that because of the inclination. He is looking up, he is looking at the northern sky. Why? He was looking at a particular place, 16 degrees above the horizon and 4 degrees to the right of the north-south axis of the sky. He is looking at the passage of this star, the hoof star, of the thigh. Why? The explanation is as simple as it is dramatic. For if at this precise moment you turn east, you will see that magical moment of the rising of the star Sirius. The architect has locked the whole complex into the machinery of the sky and of rebirth. That was a key, because I discovered later that this ritual was performed throughout the whole of Egyptian civilization, all the way to the end and even in the Greco-Roman period.
Witness Dendera, the great temple built 2,000 years after the pyramids. Even in its final phases, ancient Egypt whispers the same sacred secret here.
This temple has its main axis aligned to the Big Dipper, to the north. And look, here is Seshet, the goddess who aligns the temple to the stars of the Big Dipper. It's written everywhere.
Spelled out for all to see, the other alignment of the temple to the rising of the star Sirius.
What seems to confirm this is that there are drawings showing a Horus king with a lance actually pointing to that place in this constellation.
Bauval's quest strikes a chord with others who study how the heavens above relate to monuments below in the minds of ancient kings and priests.
They seem to have aligned to.
I like very much this idea of sacred machines. You have the cosmic order in the sky, and you have the order on the earth. And you can open connections between them. We have very famous examples in other cultures as well. For instance, Stonehenge. It means that the cosmic level and the earth level communicate.
And this is what we have here at the pyramids. We have these shafts that direct the king to the northern region, to the circumpolar stars.
As in Egypt's ancient Book of the Dead, hidden meaning to the Giza pyramid unfolds with all the main players of a cosmic drama of death and rebirth.
It's as above, so below. You see, there's a terrible feeling also among many, many modern people that these were only old superstitions. These were only these primitive peoples. There were Einsteins in those days as well.
Bringing an ancient ritual back to life triggered a flood of new insights and understanding to Bauval. And there was even more to the goddess Sashet and the stars.
Sashet, but now she is recording the Jubilees, these great Hebset festivals.
Sashet had another very, very important function, to record the years of reign of the king. This has tremendous implications. It would mean that she held the power to decide how long the king would reign, how long he would live, the years of life, because that's what reigns meant. Related to it is this, the first pyramid complex, the pyramid of Djoser at Saqqara. It is here that he had to prove his virility and his power. Marvelous festivities, colors, flags, procession, princesses, priests would come here, celebrate for 5 days. And the crescendo, like a Spanish corrida, was waiting for the king to come out himself, physically, naked, almost, wrapped around with a small loincloth, and having to run around the courts, a microcosm of Egypt. And if he could do that and still show his potency, perhaps even running after a wild bull, then the crowd would cheer and he would be given his reign. But if he did not, should the king be found old or incapable, then the country itself would suffer the same fate, and this could not be allowed. So, the implications are incredible.
Sacrifice of the king is known from other cultures. Celts, Spartans, Vikings, even amongst the African Dinka over a century ago. In earliest Egypt, a bull very soon took the place of the king. But the Hebset ritual remained crucially important, and another reason to align monuments to what happened above.
It has always been a puzzlement why the great causeway that runs from the second pyramid along the side of the Sphinx is aligned 14 degrees from the center line of the Sphinx. Let's see on the computer. They tell us that they celebrated the Jubilee on the 22nd of October. Now let's see what happens on this day. We can see that the sun rises 14 degrees to the south of east. This is exactly the alignment of the causeway of the Sphinx. This alone should suggest that one of the functions of the Giza necropolis was to celebrate the royal jubilee. And we find this all over Egypt.
The great monument of Abu Simbel, 1500 years younger than the Great Pyramids and the Sphinx. Its axis in a similar angle as the causeway of the Sphinx, the Jubilee angle. This is the dawn of the 22nd of October, the day of Hebset.
Sadly, because of the Lake Nasser, the light of the sun is a bit diffused. But were you here to witness the sharpness of the light, first the baboons would light up. These baboons in ancient times would come down on the edge of the Nile, and as the sun would rise, would greet the light of the sun and chatter and shout in joy as if speaking to the sun god. Then the sunlight comes down and shines on Rehorakti and on the sun disk that is on his head. And eventually the light strikes the face of the four colossi representing Ramses II. And at this moment, the light of the sun strikes the statues in the back. And at this precise time, it is shining over the Pharaoh himself, Ramses II, and illuminating him with Rehorakti. He merges with the sun god in the light of the sun.
Who then, or rather what, was the Pharaoh, builder of these monuments of the cosmos?
All such attention to the sky, this idea of sacred machines, was aimed as the foundation of power. The pharaoh, who was the ruler, he was founding his power on the stars. And this is, in fact, a quite common mechanism. The China emperor was the son of the sky, and so on.
You see it everywhere, the king Horus. The king Horus. The king Horus. The king is Horus. He is the sun god on earth. This isn't a representative wanting to build housing estates. This is a god on earth responsible for the cosmic law.
Egypt believed that the whole of Egypt was a mirror of the heavenly landscape, and that all the changes that occurred in the sky, the cycles of the sun and the stars as they changed, were reflected on the ground. So, we have 3,000 years of pharaonic existence. So as the sky changes from north to south in the course of these 3,000 years, so do the monuments. And the principal site not only change location, but change orientation to match in perfect synchronicity. As above, so below, the cosmic law as it functions. If you understand this, you can decode Egypt.
Contours of a sky religion in which kings and priests obeyed the laws of the universe in the course of sun and stars as they built their monuments. They lead Bauval to daring new insights into the soul of ancient Egypt, hard to detect without knowing astronomy, and even harder because of Egypt's concept of the great wheels of time.
The Egyptians created a cycle regarding that star and the sun. That is, I believe, the key to understand the whole system that they had in mind. They devised very early a solar calendar. They focus all their religious attention on the rising of the sun at the summer solstice. At the same time when that star appears. And they mention the phoenix coming to begin time.
That was Egypt's New Year's Day. And they saw the sun return to the same position 365 days afterwards. But through the years, they noticed that their New Year's Day drifted away from midsummer.
Why? Because the true solar year, of course, has 365 days and a quarter.
We add the extra day of February 29 to adjust for this leap year. But the ancient Egyptians didn't do this. To them, it was the sacred order of the gods, and it should not be changed.
And so, every 4 years, the New Year's Day moved by 1 day. And every 8 years, by 2 days, and so on, and so on, and so on.
It slowly created a different cycle of time.
It means that the seasons gradually get out of step with the artificial year, and therefore a long time must elapse, many hundreds of years, before the status quo is repeated. And this is the solstice cycle. And it obviously was a great festival.
The Sothic cycle, Greek historians called it, after Sothis, their name for Isis, from whose womb Rehoracte sprang on that special day when Egypt itself was reborn. And although the magical moment of rebirth occurred every year the same time at summer solstice, Egypt's New Year's Day on its calendar, the birth of Ra, moved further and further away from it.
It would take a full cycle 4 times 365 years, that is 1,460 years, to return back to its original point. This was the return of the phoenix.
The cycle begins on June 21st, when the sun rises far to the north. Losing 1 day every 4 years, each next generation of Egyptians saw its New Year's Day later in the year, and the sun rise away from the north. As over centuries, New Year crept towards winter, the sun would rise farther and farther to the south until winter solstice after 730 years, and then back to the north as the New Year crept back again to midsummer to complete the circle after 1460 years.
It is the reunion of the sun with the star Sirius and the flooding of the Nile. So, what happened at these points? We know from the Greeks that visited Egypt in the late period that the beginning or end of such a cycle, which the Greeks called the Sothic cycle, was in the year 139. We have a point of reference, 139 AD.
Roman authors describe Egypt exploding in celebration. Another cycle began 1460 years earlier, in 1320 BC. 730 years earlier, the New Year's Day fell at the winter solstice in 2050 BC. A further 730 years back to the summer solstice, gives 2780 BC. What happened at these points?
Well, in 2780 BC, we see a flurry of activity, an explosion of construction. Pyramids are built in the north. Temples, the Temple of Heliopolis rises. The city of Memphis rises. The solar temples of Abu Ghraib.
In centuries before, Egypt's center had moved from the south at Hierakonpolis here to the north and the sudden dawn of the Great Pyramid Age.
This is where it all began, 2800 BC. This is when a flurry of activity in building took place, an explosion that took place over the landscape. And this is the very first pyramid complex in the history of Egypt. The whole complex was surrounded by a massive perimeter wall made up of protrusions and indentations and panels. If you count the panels on each side of the wall, you will arrive at the figure of 1,460, the Phoenix Sothic cycle. Can this be a coincidence? BC. The birth of Rehorakhti took place at the time of the summer solstice, when the sun rose in the extreme north. This means that after 730 years, the birth of Rehorakhti, the New Year's Day, would have drifted from the summer solstice in the north to the winter solstice in the south at sunrise. Now, if it is true that the ancient Egyptians believed that the land was an image of the heavens, then we should find a center at the distant south, 730 years later, after the establishment of the calendar, that is directed to the winter solstice. And what do we find there? Indeed, we find the center of Karnak that was begun at the year 2050 BC, exactly 730 years after the establishment of the calendar. And we see that its axis is directed to the winter solstice. I am convinced that these great solar kings of Egypt, whose duty was to uphold that cosmic order and to follow it, I am convinced that they did precisely this. They weren't interested in building housing estates and housing developments. They were building centers for the sun, for the return of the phoenix to take place at these prescribed times. The center of Karnak was begun at the year 2050 BC. Now, if we add 730 years forward in time, we get the year 1,330
320 BC. We would expect again some major event to take place. We would expect to find a pharaoh who would move the cult from the south back to the north. And what we have here, the heretical pharaoh Akhenaten moving his cult to a new city in Tell el Amarna.
In the decennia preceding the year 1320, the great birth of Ra, the Sothic cycle again complete, emerges the most enigmatic figure in Egypt's history, Akhenaten.
He did make a dramatic change. The Egyptians worshipped many gods, and now this individual who come and said, no, you only worship what is behind the sun. He was a deep man who thought about what we believe today, the idea of the one God. And this is why I always tell people, I always bow for this man, Akhenaten.
Akhenaten dispenses with all the iconography and retains only the sun disk as his image of the sun god. And then he does something far more radical.
One has to get into the mindset of this enigmatic king. Here he is, after 1,400 years of waiting for the order to restore itself back. And he is the chosen one. He is the pharaoh that is born at that time. It must have exploded in his mind that he was a sort of solar messiah, the one who would bring back the order. That is the great vision of Akhenaten. He wanted to do it with such fervor that he went against the priesthood. He went against all the advice at the time and took all the priests, all the nobility, all his family, in one go, a mini exodus to a new city in Tell el Amarna.
And there he sets a great temple to the god of the sun disk, the Aten.
Could the Sothic cycle nearing its completion, when all came together again, have inspired Akhenaten's revolution?
I would rather wait for additional proofs, but it's a very interesting idea because this Sothic cycle was a constant in the mind of the Egyptian for, say, 3,000 years or so.
Here we have a plan of the great Aten temple. And what is interesting is that there is 730 orders, the Sothic number again.
This was a period that has fascinated generations upon generations, but nothing more fascinating than the enigmatic queen Nefertiti. And she probably bathed here in this pool.
Only mistake that Akhenaten did, he made the Egyptians worship the new god through him. Because the Egyptian thought that he is the connection between them and Aten, and this why he was the god himself. Then when he died, the Atenism completely finished, and the other gods came back again.
I'm standing at the entrance of the great temple of Aten, 500 meters long, and that's all that is left of a great idea lost in the rumble and the dust of time.
The year 1320 comes after Akhenaten's death. In times of upheaval, civil strife, even foreign invasion later on, the Sothic ideal seems to fade with time. But there is another phenomenon which brings Bauval to an even more far-reaching and controversial proposal about ancient Egypt and how it observed the stars.
When you talk about the stars, it isn't just their journey across the night sky. There is something else to consider. Remember this, the spinning top of this driver. Imagine that this is the Earth and that every revolution is one day. But see what happens.
It's ABC to astronomers. Very slowly, the axis of the Earth wobbles. One turn every 26,000 years.
And the effect of this is that the stars appear to move slowly in the 26,000 years cycle we call precession.
Precession makes our sun appear to rise in different constellations over periods of 2,000 years and stars to go slowly up and down through the epochs. Bauval thinks the Egyptians became aware of it through time. Witness this temple in Elephantine in the south.
Setet, the goddess of the Nile flood, and this her temple has its origins in the Old Kingdom around 2500 BC. But there are several temples built one on top of the other, like a wedding cake. We are seeing the temple here, the final temple built at the time of Christ. And what is striking is that the axis of each successive temple is directed to the star Sirius at the time the temple was built, proving their obsession with the star and how they observed it through the ages.
You can observe it in Dendera or in the temple of Karnak.
And here too we can see how the axis of the temple changes in the direction of the northern stars.
If ancient Egypt noticed precession through the millennia, then Bauval arrives at a stunning possibility. It has to do with the core of its being, where all myths converge. Zeptepi, the first time. Ancient Egypt believed that here is where it all began, the mound of creation. But when did it begin? Controversy has raged about the age of the Sphinx. Some believe it to be thousands of years older than thought so far, but there's no doubt where he looks at.
And he looks due east when the sun rises at the equinox. It is obvious that he is a marker of time, but the time that he really tells is the first time, the beginning of time, Zeptepi. When the Lion King on Earth looked at the cosmic lion and the sun in the sky at 11,500 BC.
11,500 BC? But astrologists would indeed call this the age of Leo, when the sun rose in that constellation. And if ancient Egypt believed, as above so below, the lion on Earth would indeed look at the lion in heaven.
The idea of it being a lion, these very bright people who set up these monuments were highly intelligent and they did nothing out of sheer abandon. They had a good, logical, according to their beliefs, scenario, and they kept to it.
And there's more to suggest an unbelievable scenario.
And remember precession.
11,500 BC is the time when Sirius first appeared in the land of Egypt at the magical day of rebirth.
This is what I think the Egyptians meant when they spoke of the first time and the coming of the phoenix to create the cycle of time. Let's look at this landscape carefully, this place, this region where they tell us was the beginning of time, the time of creation.
Under the pharaohs, the Giza pyramids had their tops covered in gold, as had others nearby. Egyptologists have begun to wonder whether this was to make them connect with other monuments within sight. The father of astronomy, the Greek Eudoxus, describes a large tower where Egypt's priests came to observe the stars at what the ancients called Letopolis, some 20 miles due north of the Great Pyramid. It's diagonal, aimed at the great temple of Heliopolis. The three formed a straight triangle, visible day and night as sun and moon lit up their golden tops.
Now imagine that you were at Letopolis at that time of 11,500 BC, and you were looking directly south. What would you see? A landscape that is uncannily similar to what you have on the ground. The Nile in alignment with the Milky Way. The three stars of Orion's belt exactly in the same angle and in the same configuration as the pyramids on the ground. And when you go east, here is what you would see. The constellation of Leo, this Horakhti in the sky, directly over the temple of Ra Horakhti. And a short while later, you would see the sun blazing right above the temple. This cannot be a coincidence.
The sky locked in the image of an incredibly distant past. And Bauval sees even more that points to 11,500 BC, to the ancient Egyptians. The 70 days when the star Sirius disappeared from the sky were crucial. Mummification, all of Egypt awaited the moment of rebirth, these 70 days.
Now let's see what happens in the sky. The sun is here in this position, in Leo, when the star is being reborn at dawn. But let's see what happened 70 days before. The whole landscape of the sky seems to be slipping, and the sun is moving backwards. We're going to a place somewhere about here on the west side of the Milky Way.
If as above, so below holds true, west of the Milky Way should take us west of the Nile.
Now, if this theory is correct, if these three stars represent the three pyramids on the ground, we know that the pyramids are 950 meters apart. Working on the same scale, this distance should be about 9.5 kilometers. We should expect to find some sort of sun temple, probably a sort of sun harbor, where the sun is about to cross the Milky Way and head towards the constellation of Leo, the Horakhti, the temple of Horakhti in the sky. So let's see what we have on the ground. And as predicted, here we are at the sun temple of Abu Ghraib. And if you follow the alignment of this axis, you will see that it is exactly 9.5 kilometers from the Great Pyramid of Giza. This area here seems to be a sort of pharaonic religious port, with even a ship and a causeway that is directed to Heliopolis in that direction. We have a landscape that is interrelated. Heliopolis, Letopolis, Giza, Abu Ghraib, and seems to be in exactly the image of the first time landscape in the sky.
A mirror of the sky in 11,500 BC. Pretty far-fetched indeed. Does Bauval mean that monuments were built thousands of years earlier than we've thought so far?
This is where it all began, 2800 BC.
No, with the exception of the Sphinx, perhaps.
And this is the very first pyramid complex in the whole history of Egypt.
His theory proposes that at the dawn of history, Egypt felt the need to graft some very distant memory in stone, thousands of years old, and etch it into its mind forever of how it began, the first time. Was there such an event?
Egypt experienced major and dramatic changes at the end of the Ice Age, when very high, exceptionally high floods covered the floodplain.
The time the ice began to melt, when the poles suddenly jerked away to new positions, when something wiped out the animals of North America.
Any mammal larger than a coyote largely became extinct within a few tens of years. Yes, that is, in fact, a great catastrophe.
When the average temperature in the world shot up with as much as 5 degrees.
And that change occurred over maybe 3 years to only a couple of decades, close to what we see today.
The sudden end of the Ice Age around 11,000 BC, when sea levels rose and within decades, the North Sea and the Baltic came into being. And something happened in the heart of Africa. Great lakes had filled up and joined each other. Now torrential rains flooded Central Africa, and a huge new stream cut north, first filled up great swamp basins, then broke out to the valley of an older stream, the smaller Blue Nile, coming out of Ethiopia. Where now lies the city of Khartoum, Blue and White Nile, joined into the river that was to shape and destine the land of Egypt. For the first time, sometime around 11,000 BC. Was this Zeptepi the first time? But how would a primitive society preserve the memory? Keep count of thousands of years? Impossible. But ancient Egypt and what preceded it did not only count in years, it counted the great wheels of time, the Sothic cycles. At the dawn of history, Pharaoh Djoser laid it down in the first great pyramid complex, and if they knew then, could they have known the previous cycle and the previous? The first time. Bauval finds it commemorated in their myths and monuments, and in the stars. Alexandria, towards the beginning of our era. The Roman general Julius Caesar is too absorbed in Egypt's mysteries to listen to ambassadors of its last queen, Cleopatra. Caesar's timekeepers use a confusing, inaccurate lunar calendar to keep track of time. He has a great interest for Egypt's cycle of 365 years. A superior timekeeping device.
They had understood the cosmic order. They did not need the reformation of the calendar. They had a calendar that re-established itself on its own every cycle of 1,460 years, plus or minus.
In the end, Caesar names the months we know, December, January, and adopts Egypt's calendar, but not quite. He takes 365 days and a quarter, and it takes until today to adjust it and correct it. Instead of Egypt's great wheels of time, time going forward, God knows where.
We now need the meager means of the Southern Lycho to evoke the greatness of an ancient people who sought to build heaven on earth. Today we can hardly see the stars, let alone the Milky Way. We are no longer stirred by their magic, and so we have robbed ourselves of a greatness that once was ours.